I don't know how many go in the article, in the paper, but our author today is Robert W. Gardner. He's actually the husband of Melissa, who works in our lab on Mondays through Thursday nights and on Saturdays. Because I'm Melissa, and you know half the group. He has been, he worked in broadcasting for 25 years. He is also involved with the softball theater group. Yeah, and he is working on starting a Bible believers. I'll let you explain that. And this is his first book, and he's going to share with you about it and his inspiration behind writing it. So I'm going to turn it over to Robert. Thank you.
Thank you. All right, folks. Don't mind, I'll take my glasses off. I don't know if I'll put them back on or not. I am indeed Robert W. Gardner. Nobody else wanted to be. So about 20 years ago, I started work on this, and I started with the Gospel of John. And what I wanted to do, and you may not be able to read it very well, but what I wanted to do is reformat the way a Bible is printed. Ever since Gutenberg and the Gutenberg Bible, we've been trying to squeeze as much text on a page as we can. So you have these huge blocks of text, often very fine print. This saves printing costs, and the book then doesn't become huge. That is not a natural way to read. If you look at like Hebrew, for example, they will parse out the various phrases in a sentence, each on its separate line. This way you can, as you're reading along, you can see the entire phrase on its own separate line, and then it makes a bit more sense. I also wanted to indent whenever I have someone speaking, which further separates out so that you can see that. She mentioned that I was a broadcaster for 25 years. And so I read a lot of things aloud. I read things on sight reading without, almost like reading music. But and I would have to do this live, and sometimes it was what we would call rip and read. And often, in church, I might be called upon to read. And and you open up to a certain set of scriptures, and you just start reading. And back in back where when I grew up, it was King James, and I went to church with people who prayed in King James, and King James is not easy to read. So it occurred to me that it would be easier to read, and you can see in some of these how that's laid out. It looks like poetry almost. So it falls out like poetry. And Ted already has his copy. So the other thing that I wanted to do, as someone who was a Bible teacher and someone who liked to read aloud to people, I wanted to take the story of Jesus, and rather than skip back and forth, and this is not a substitute for Bible study, but this is just another way to tell the story. And so rather than skip back and forth from Matthew to Luke and try to find where both of them said something about the same event, I wanted to paraphrase it all together. This is not a translation, but although I consulted a lot of translations, I consulted a lot of commentaries, and I passed this to a lot of different pastors for peer review. This is not a substitute for the Bible. It's just another way to tell the story. And that, of course, is the primary mission of the church, to tell the story of Jesus to every nation and, if possible, to every person. And, well, it is possible, and one day we'll get there. As a little side note, it's possible that some of you in this room may still be breathing when we get that job done. We're very close to finishing the Great Commission, and it's an exciting time to live. So I just wanted one more tool out there, and if you don't mind, I'd like to demonstrate how easy it is. Pick a number between 1 and 271.
36.
36. All right.
Is it the Gospel of John?
Well, John is in it. In this case, this is a vignette entitled, "The Fishermen Are Called to Be Disciples." And that was a good pick because this is from Matthew 4, 18 through 22, Mark 1, 16 through 20, Luke 5, 1 through 3. Now, in a lot of cases, the language is going to be very close. Mark was the first gospel published. Matthew had taken a lot from Mark, and Luke did as well. So in a lot of cases, the phrases were the same. So we weren't just simply repeating the phrase three times in the course of combining these sets of scriptures. We simply told the story one time from all three. And so just co-reading here. "And it came to pass that Jesus was walking by the Sea of Gennesaret, or Galilee, and the people pressed in on him to hear the word of God. As he stood by the water, he saw two brethren, Simon, called Peter, and Andrew, his brother, casting a net into the water, for they were fishermen. He saw two boats standing by on the sea, but the fishermen had left them and were washing their nets. He said to them, 'Follow me, and I will make you fishers of men.' And they immediately abandoned their nets and followed him. Going a little farther from there, he saw two other brothers, James and John, in a ship with Zebedee, their father, mending their nets. He called them, and they immediately left the boat and their father and the hired servants and followed him. He got into Simon's boat and asked him if he would push out a little from the land. Then he sat down and taught the people out of the boat." If that was a big block of text and wasn't parsed out into phrases like that, that would have been a lot harder for me to read, and I might have made more mistakes than I did. So that's what I wanted, was something for reading comprehension. It's not enough just to have the story in front of people. You want people to understand it. And for people who do a lot of reading aloud, which was the way people used to read back in the oldest days, this makes it an easier job. And it's also, in this little excerpt right here, I'm showing you the format. I cite all of the Bible verses that are used so that you can go to your own Bibles and research it from there if you like. And then again, each phrase of the sentence has its own line. So you have actually four different lines for that one sentence. Another convention that I do is anytime I'm talking about Jesus, everybody talks about pronouns these days. Well, the divine pronoun is always capitalized in this. That's not always the case in a biblical text. But then he told his disciples, and that he will send out laborers into his harvest. So I always capitalize that. That helps us know who is talking and who is being referred to. Another convention in this book is whenever we're quoting from the Old Testament, and that's done a lot, well, I kept that in King James English just to give people a feeling of how antiquated the speech of that time of the Old Testament days was in the days when Jesus was alive. There is less time between us and Shakespeare and the King James Bible than there was between Jesus and the last of the Old Testament authors. So the Hebrews, the Judeans, I should say, who were living in the Roman province of Judea, those people, reading from the ancient text, were reading a language that they were not speaking in exactly the same manner. A lot of them, like Jesus, spoke Aramaic, which is a variety of Hebrew. And so the pure, raw Hebrew of the Old Testament scriptures that would be read in the synagogues and that would be...
Come on. Sorry, you mean those shores?
Oh, my. So the language was different. And so because of that, just to show the antiquity of the scriptures that were being cited, I would keep that, I would put that in italics, and I would use the King James. Another convention I did was when demons are quoted, I used a different font entirely, so that it stands out as something totally different. And I just wanted those things in this book. In the course of combining, well, before I get to that, let me mention that one of the things that I did was, as well as I could research it, come up with the modern equivalents in currency and in measurement. When it says that in the wedding of Cana, when Jesus takes six big vessels, water pots they were, for ceremonial washing, and there were six of them there, and the Bible says it held between 20 and 30 firkins. Well, that's King James, and who knows how much a firkin is? Well, I didn't, so I had to look that up and find out. So by doing that, we wind up with learning the equivalent amount in our measurements. So this comes up to be about between 20 and 30 gallons apiece. So times six, that's between 120 and 180 gallons of wine suddenly made, and pretty good wine too. I went to the Vivino website. Now this was in 2020 when I did this. No telling what inflation has done to this now. I went to the Vivino website, which provides the range of wine prices averaged around the world. A average bottle is about $16. A very good wine would be just over twice that. And the most excellent bottles you can purchase run about 33 times that much. So if this was the most excellent wine possible, then Jesus would have given that couple $316,800 worth of wine. If it was just good wine, then it was still worth, in 2020 dollars, $19,200. It's something else to find that out, and that was just a side note in here, way back in all of the end notes that we have, where just for the sake of decent scholarship and transparency, I wanted to make sure that people could check my work. And so we find that sort of thing out when Nicodemus and Jesus buried Jesus. From the book of John, we're told that Nicodemus purchased about 100 litra of burial spices. Now, a litra was about 12.5 ounces, so 100 litra would be 78.15 pounds. It's often paraphrased as a modern measure of about 75 pounds of burial spices. This was, by any standard, a kingly burial. And you find out how rich Nicodemus was when you start looking into the prices of the burial spices. The aloes that were referred to were probably the spice, not aloe vera, like you might think. This was aloes wood, or agar wood, as it's called today. Egyptian myrrh can be, so it was aloes and myrrh. These were the burial spices. At this writing, Egyptian myrrh could be purchased in bulk for $457.90 a pound. However, so that means if you take half of your 75 pounds, 37.5 pounds, you're looking at spending $17,171.25 just for the myrrh. And that was the cheap part. If the other half of it was the agar wood or aloes wood, according to Flavor and Fragrance Journal, the premium oil, and you can find it on Amazon still, the premium oil is $1,187 an ounce. So right. That...
in the time,
yeah.
Relatively speaking,
yes.
Would it have been a very expensive at that time?
Yes, ma'am. Very expensive. And that's one of the reasons why John made note of what spices were used and how much were used, because Nicodemus and Josephus gave Jesus a kingly burial. So if you combined those costs, if they were equal amounts, you're looking at a total of almost $730,000 worth of burial spices. Nobody did that. It was an amazing thing, and that's why it was important to put it in the Bible. You know, you wonder why did they say how much it is and what it is? Doesn't matter. It matters. That was an amazing thing. There's another interesting part in here, and this was not my scholarship. I found this, of course, elsewhere. There have been many Bible scholars much better than me, and I've relied heavily upon them. The genealogy of Jesus is something that has sometimes been used as a point of confusion for some people, because in Matthew you have it told one way, and in Luke it is told another way. And what we have always understood was that one of them was giving the genealogy of Mary, and the other was giving the genealogy of Joseph. For a long time, it was taught, and this was due to some scholar back in the 6th century deciding that one of them had written it one way and the other had written it the other. And he was wrong, quite frankly. And we know this because we know from the early church fathers of the 1st and 2nd century, we're talking about first of all, we know that Mary went to live with John the Apostle, and they lived in Ephesus. And there was one of his students was Polycarp. I don't know if you've heard that name or not, but if you look up Polycarp, you'll find out that he was one of the early church fathers, and he was a direct student of John. He would have known Mary, the mother of Jesus. And his student, Clement, who actually saw various writings set forth in the hands of the apostles and their students. So you have John, Polycarp, and Clement. And all of them are saying that the Gospel of Luke used the lineage of Mary. And so that was an important point. One of the things that you see in those two lineages is that they describe, they go through there and they say, okay, it's 15 generations from this one to that one, and 15 from this one to this one, and 15 from that one to Jesus. But then you count, and it's only 14 on that last set. And they're like, how is this possible? There's another thing that happens in that, and this is important. In Matthew, chapter 1, verse 16, and Jacob begat Joseph, the husband of Mary, of whom was born Jesus, who is called Christ. Well, that's how it's always been translated. However, the Hebrew from which it was translated, we have to remember that Matthew was a Jew writing to Jews. And this got transcribed. And as you know, the Hebrew language does not use vowels. It uses all consonants. And so the consonants that were used were essentially like a G. Oh, that's a bad marker. A G, a W, and an A, and an R. And this could be either, if you didn't know your Hebrew very well, you might say that that was husband. You might also say that it was the word gawa, which meant the kinsman redeemer. So if you translate that as gawa rather than guna, husband, what you wind up with is that Mary was the ward of a man named Joseph, not the wife of the particular Joseph that Luke talks about in his genealogy. And all of a sudden, all the problems go away immediately. This scholarship was from Andrew Gabriel Roth, proofs of the Peshitta originality in the gospel. And that refers to looking at the ancient texts that we have that were written in Aramaic, essentially. So there's so much scholarship behind this, and I am not an authority. I am was trying to resolve the issues and looking at the scholarship that resolved them and that did it logically. There are other places where we are resolving issues, such as the where you have the demon-possessed man. When Jesus lands on a particular shore, and these guys come raging naked. They've been cutting themselves with stones, and they come running down the slopes to oh, Jesus, thou Son of God, and he tells them to shut up. Well, one of them did all the talking, and the other one was just along, and who knows whether he uttered any word that anyone could understand. But in one gospel, it looks like they only refer to the one who's doing the talking, and in one of the other gospels, they talk about the two men. So how do you resolve that? By simply understanding that there were two men and one of them was doing the talking. So that was one of the things that I wanted to do with this as we harmonized all of these gospel stories, was to write it out in one narrative that was easy to read, that was easy to understand, and that gave the scholarship that resolved the difficulties that people like to make out of the Bible. That's about it. That's about all that I have to say about the book.
I have another question.
Yes, ma'am.
You keep referring to we, that we want to resolve. Who is the we that you're referring to?
The we would be the Christian scholars who believe in the Bible, as opposed to the critical theory schools that are looking for reasons not to believe.
Second question. What is your background? What is your biblical background?
I was ordained a minister in the year 2001. It was a wild Baptist ordination. I was at a particular church in Saraland, Alabama. The pastor stood up one Sunday morning and said, "I am not fit to be your pastor," and he walked out the back door. This was on the same day that we had just said farewell to the lady who he had appointed as the youth leader, and they were off to Gatlinburg in the church vans, and he and she were having an affair, as it turned out. And I had a week before then been made the administrator of the church, and I could both read and write. My first call to the ministry was back in the 1980s, and I had done a little bit of preaching in various nursing homes and on occasions on Wednesday nights, and thought that I was going to become a Methodist minister for a while, but they really wanted somebody with a psychology degree. When I was in this little Baptist church that suddenly did not have a pastor and didn't have the money to hire anybody at this point, because when that pastor left, about half the congregation left as well and did not come back, and so they suddenly were strapped. And so they said, well, Robert, can we ordain you? And they gathered a group of local pastors, and I had an ordination in that manner. There at Romar Beach Baptist Church, we ordained Kenny Fowler in the same manner. So as for the rest of it, it's just been pure study. My grandfather was a Methodist minister. I inherited his library, and I've gone to church all my life. I've studied the Bible all my life. And that's my background. I do not have a seminary degree.
That's fine. I don't think you need a seminary degree.
Yes, sir.
You referred to some Old Testament, but does this only pertain to the New Testament? Or?
Yes, this is essentially the four Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. I use a little bit of Paul when we talk about the Last Supper. And I use a little bit about the book of Acts because from the first couple of chapters of the book of Acts, because I just want to tidy it up. So I end with the Ascension, rather than ending with the resurrection.
I have a question. One other thing, and you know, kind of what my religious stuff is, but one of the problems I have a lot of times is that people will quote certain phrases or sentences, or basically just words from scripture, and because they feel it pertains to a point that they're trying to make. And if they read the whole verse, the whole story, the whole thing, it's not. I mean, was this kind of an attempt to get to clarify that? Because it's so annoying when somebody will say these words and it's like, you don't know what you're talking about. I mean, it's like, but so-and-so said that in relation to, you know, I can't think of anything specific right now.
Well, context is everything.
Yeah, and I was like, they don't.
Context is everything. Those who have come to believe in the Bible understand that it really does not contradict itself. And that was what I was doing, setting up that these are not contradictions. These are just different eyewitness accounts of the same story. And as you would with a court case, for example, you have several eyewitnesses and you want to figure out what the truth is judicially as well as you can. And so you put the story together from what the eyewitnesses have told you. And it's not that any of them are lying, they just had different points of view. One of them is only talking about the demon-possessed guy who was talking, the other one is not. A famous couple of words out of scripture, and you hear this a lot, Jesus said, "Judge not, lest ye be judged." And you see my King James background, I still, whenever I quote, I'm still out of the King James, but. It says, "Judge not, lest ye be judged." And people say that, will take that to mean, well, you can't judge that person over there. You can't say that they're wrong. You can't say that what they're doing is not right. You're judging. Well, it's also said judgment begins in the church. to give you an example of that, we had a governor recently in the state of Alabama who was basically caught red-handed philandering. And he was a Sunday school teacher in his church. And that church removed him from his post as a Sunday school teacher, and they removed him from the roles of that church. That's a church discipline thing, and Jesus sets that out in the book of Matthew, how you go about doing that. The other day, famously, the archbishop over in San Francisco area has told his priests there, you cannot give this congresswoman communion, not communion, the Eucharist. You cannot do that because she is embracing and promoting what the Catholic Church considers to be a mortal sin. And so that sort of church discipline has become very, very rare. But there must be judgment. And yet we have people who tell you, no, don't judge. Don't judge. And so that's an example of somebody twisting scripture to mean what they want it to mean, rather than what it really means in the context of all things. I am not to judge whether Sharon or Ted or Suzanne or Sonia is saved or not. If they say that they have been born again of the Spirit of God, I can't judge whether that's actually true or not, because, you know, I was at their wedding. And it was a great affair, and like the wedding in Canaan, there were a few people there who might have gotten just a little intoxicated. Wine maketh the heart merry. Now, am I supposed to say, these sinners can't be going to heaven because they were sinning? Can I do that? No, that's the kind of judgment that we're talking about there. So I didn't mean to preach, but that's one of the things that I want to do with this book, is provide a context. And sometimes context is difficult when, if you're not a Bible scholar, if you haven't spent your life, as I grew up, the joke is that I had a drug problem because my parents drugged me to church all the time. So people who aren't used to it, they'll read a scripture in one gospel, and then they read something else in another gospel, and it's hard to put it all together if you haven't just been steeped in it. And so this, I hope, is a tool that helps provide context. Ted?
Yes, so as you say, this is an attempt to make interpreting the Bible, understanding the Bible easier. You converting it to modern units of measurements and costs and so forth. Now, if you remember, the original Bible was written, some claim was written in Greek, translated by King James. And there was also a lot of debate on the accuracy of translation and so forth. But then the church services by the Catholic Church were conducted in Latin as the original. And there was a lot of hoopla and commotion about 40 some years ago when the Pope decreed that the church service would be conducted in the language of the country where the church is. So they converted, they started conducting church service in Spanish and in German and so forth. Because the church, they're very sensitive in somebody meddling with their original. Did you receive any flag from anyone, or did you have it from church when you announced that you were trying to put this in circulation?
Not so much. When I made a little Facebook page for it, I did have some internet trolls get on there, and some of them are saying, we don't need another Bible. We don't need a retelling. What are you adding to it? My response is, I'm not adding anything to it. I did not consult the English translation of the Latin Vulgate when I wrote this, but I looked at a lot of other translations. And these days, we have so many manuscripts from the days of the early church fathers, and so much scholarship has been done that we are very confident that the text that we have received is the best text from all of the ancient works which are available to us. Something upwards of 99% of it checks out, with that other less than 1% being due to translation errors here or there, and really more transcription errors than translation errors. So it's the people of the day took the Bible, those letters, the epistles of the apostles and the gospels that were written, they took those very, very seriously. And they were written in a time when there were hundreds, literally thousands and thousands of eyewitnesses to the events. And so it's extremely implausible that any of it was simply made up. And we also have a record of each of the various Bibles that were put together and written. What we know as the Bible today stems, first of all, from the work of Desiderius Erasmus, who was said to be the last scholar who had read every book printed. Shortly after that, we got the Gutenberg Bible, and then books proliferated, and it's no longer possible to say that you have read every book. But he put it out from Greek texts, and that was the basis for the Bibles written by Tyndale and then later translated by the team that was put together under King James. And Shakespeare might have been on that team. We think that's a possibility. That's never been proven one way or the other, but it's a nice little rumor.
Yeah, but like Book of Ruth, where did I go? I read it like Shakespeare. Mm-hmm. It just seems to have that. Maybe that's why I always like that verse. It reads like Shakespeare.
It's beautiful. The Holy Bible, because of the King James Bible, and this is just something interesting in the history of it, it sort of crystallized the English language. You had this island nation there with Gaelic spoken, with Welsh spoken, with Pictish spoken, and then here come the Anglos, and here come the Saxons, and here come the Norse, and then in 1066, here come the French. And of course, plenty of Germans with your Saxons and what have you. So you wound up with this island nation that was speaking English any old way. And when the King James Bible came out, it standardized the English language. Now it's changed some, but you can still pick up a King James Bible and understand what they mean. You might have to look up a firkin and find out what that is, but you can still understand the language itself. And that did an amazing thing in my mind to the English-speaking world. I studied French in high school and tried to study it in college. The language is strange to me. It didn't make sense to my mind because I was learning it as an adult, for one thing. But arguably, I was not an adult in high school. All I remembered from my French classes, I made straight A's. But I was like a parrot. I could just repeat whatever the teacher was saying, and it wouldn't give me an A for it. I remembered the French national anthem, and that was about all that I learned from that. And I couldn't tell you everything that it meant. And the reason why it bothered me so much, and my autism spectrum mind couldn't make sense of it, was, again, pronouns. A television is la télévision. La is a feminine pronoun, as opposed to le télévision. Well, it's, why is it a female television? How am I supposed to know that? That makes no sense. In England, in Great Britain, over time, with all of these languages pouring in and all of these people trying to make sense of things with one another, they picked the best pieces of all of these languages and put it together in a structure that made sense. And the King James Bible crystallized that structure. And I think that is one of the reasons why the English-speaking peoples have been so successful across the planet until this point, because the language is actually better. We don't need 200 words for snow like the Eskimo do, but we could still describe it. And with the mathematics and everything else that was developed by all sorts of people, we have the tools with the English language to describe any situation and to think about it logically. Probably the only language that might be more logical in some ways is Greek. that did a lot to affect the course of history itself. Just the fact that we were thinking and speaking in a language that made the most logical sense in the world. Until you try to figure out which way to spell there.
Do you have any plans to do that with other sections of the Bible?
None at the moment, I don't. This lent itself to this project, and this project was, in my mind, more necessary. Because you had four different sources that I wanted to combine to make one story, as opposed to the letters of Paul. I have paraphrased the letters of John, for example. I have done that work. But there's not as much reason to, because I don't have three different versions of the letters of John. I just have 1 John, 2 John, and 3 John, and so I'm not worried about that. I've paraphrased all of the works of John, actually. I also paraphrased the Revelation. Again, I don't have three different versions of it to compare and contrast, and so I didn't see a reason to do that. My next project will be to record an audio book of this, and at some point I would like to do a second edition. If any of you get this book and look through it and find some things of interest, or things that are questionable, or places where there is a typo or a mistake, get in touch with me and let me know. A little snowbird lady from, I think, Michigan, Pat Bluth was her name. She got a copy of my book after I had received a copy of her book. And I said, if you find anything in it, let me know. She came back 2 weeks later with a notepad full of all sorts of things. And most of these, now in some cases, it was just a little typo or something. But in others, and I mentioned I was steeped in King James from early on. And so there are places where my modernization of the language did not completely remove the phrasing of the King James Bible. And so in some places, and I can't tell you where at the moment, some places there's a phrase or two that might be a little stilted. And so if I do a second edition, then I want to go in, go through and make corrections and make improvements to that. I'd also like to go red letters on Jesus. I'd like to include some illustrations. I like the work of Gustave Doré. He had a whole school of people that did engravings, and all of these, of course, now in the public domain. And there's a Doré Bible out there, a couple of different versions of that. So I'd like to include some of those great illustrations from that time, if I do a second edition. Do you have any other questions? All right then. In that case, we can wrap up early and get to coffee and donuts. if there's any.
Are we supposed to wait?
I do have one.
Yes,
question.
Ma'am.
I'm one of those people that read various sources when I'm doing my daily meditation.
Yes, ma'am.
And I'll use your example here. Let's see. Then he told his disciples, the harvest is truly great. Well, my brain would immediately go to the number one, I hope harvest has a footnote that I can go back and see what exactly he meant. In other words, for clarification. And so in that sense, your book would be very useful to people who may want to harvest. I mean, you know, if they're fairly new to reading scripture, what does he mean by the harvest? You know, that kind of stuff. Does that make any sense?
Yes, ma'am. this is not really a Bible commentary or study guide.
Oh.
So the footnotes that I have in the end of the book, there are a lot of them.
Yeah, I love my
footnotes. Yeah, so I have quite a few there.
Oh, I see.
And sometimes I do a little exposition. But I don't have a footnote for every single vignette.
Yeah.
But I do try to provide some explanation. But as far as explaining the business of the harvest and what that meant to ancient civilization, I'll leave that to the local preacher.
It seems to me that this would be really good for a new Christian.
Yes, ma'am.
You know, to collate, get it all together.
Yes, ma'am. I have actually had a couple of pastors tell me that they've been using it as a part of their daily study. And I think it just clarifies. I started doing excerpts from this, and Suzanne will perhaps remember this. Like around Christmas and Easter, Chris Fowler would play the piano, and we'd pause and sing a little something, but I wanted to tell the whole story of Christmas. I wanted to tell the whole story of Easter or of Pentecost or what have you. And so this was just a good way for me to go ahead and do that and combine all the scriptures together so that you're telling the whole story and you're not flipping back and forth that way.
You said that you had paraphrased or taken the Book of Revelations. Do you have that in book form or in readable form or something that you could be ordered?
No, it's not available right now. I've got it as a text. If you want to email me, I can send you the text.
Okay.
But it's not as finished a word as this is. Any other questions? Comments? Yes, sir.
You had mentioned audio one.
I intend to do that, yes, sir. I haven't recorded
any
it.
Time frame?
I'd like to finish that before the end of this year. I hope. That's not a promise. Well, thank you so much, everyone, for coming out, and thank you for your questions.
Signing books today.
I am signing books today.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. The books are $20 each. If you want to go to Amazon, you can find the book.